next presentation by Professor Pilar León-Sanz, who is the professor at the Navarra University. She is an expert in the field of history of medicine and pharmacy, but she also draws interest to the ethical in medicine. The lecture will consist of two parts. We will hear about the shaping or coining the term of care for the patients in the medieval ages. And the second part, the professor will tell us whether it was possible to contradict dehumanization in the relation between patient and the doctor. Professor, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's an honor for me to participate in the 600th commemoration of St. John of Tucla. Thank you very much for inviting me to this important conference. I want to congratulate the organizers for all their very valuable work. In the late 18th century, Jacques Tenon stated that the state of the hospital measured the nature of a civilization. In effect, healthcare institutions reflect the way society structures itself and vice versa. Healthcare systems illustrate key aspects of human nature, since forms of healthcare derive from people's values, desires, and projects in a society at any given time. Further, examining the assistance to the poor and the needy allows us to see and deepen our understanding of certain features of society, particularly its views on the sick or the weak. In this presentation, I will begin by explaining how the renewed spirituality of the mendicant orders influenced the culture of medieval cities between the 13th and 15th centuries, when St. John of Tucla lived, and contributed to shaping a new way of understanding the care of the needy or the infirm. Franciscans and mendicant orders also influenced the definition of hell at that time. In the second part, I will explore the evolution of the concept of caring in medicine in a more recent period, an evolution related to that tradition since, as we shall see, respect for the patient as a person was crucial for the configuration of the art and the science of medicine. Franciscan spirituality, based on true love and charity, as well as the notion of extreme humility, led the friars as St. John of Tucla to identify with the disposed and thus influence the care provided by society to the poor and sick. Such care was an occasion for a public manifestation of Christian faith. The way to live the gospel mandate of love and the teachings of the Sermon on the Beatitudes. In the Middle Ages, the love for the poor was articulated as the six major works of mercy: to feed the hungry, to give drink to the thirsty, to shelter the homeless, to clothe the naked, to visit the sick, to visit those imprisoned, to which was added the mandate to bury the dead. The mendicant orders, such as the Franciscans, developed tertiary congregations which offered lay people the opportunity to live the ideals of religious life. Combining ordinary activities with religious practices as a way to facilitate their obtaining spiritual benefits. The tertiary mendicant movement was strongly rooted in urban areas of both bourgeois and noble extraction. These people, many of whom were healthy, wealthy, developed welfare system to deal with poverty and mendicancy. Furthermore, they carry out the new social ethics developed by religious order based on the idea of social responsibility in the face of collective problems and on a new understanding of the common good. Health began to be one of the goods, common or public, most valuable in the cities of the Western Christianity. The deep religiosity of the medieval and early modern European society led to the belief that physical and spiritual health were closely linked. This did not imply that physical health had spiritual purposes, but that it could support spirituality. For example, Ramon Llull, who probably belonged to the Third Order Franciscans, encouraged people to care for their health because, I quote, "If your own body stays healthy by temperance, you can serve God with all your senses and imagination," end quote. The concern for collective health in medieval communities had at least two more implications. First, the new association due to the Franciscan and Dominicans of theology with university medicine reinforced the status of the physicians trained in universities. Second, municipalities and emerging states promoted public health measures and urban sanitation by means of street cleaning, food control, waste disposal, and so on. And more importantly for us, it began to develop a new kind of hospital. The new hospital provided a more specialized care based on patients' needs. This new model of general hospital remained essentially unchanged throughout the old regime until the 19th century. It was a period in which the imperative of Christian charity continued to drive the various welfare and healthcare initiatives. In this new section, I will discuss the development of these ideas in relation to the notion of curing as practiced by the health professionals, and how this concept connects with the notion of caring for patients. In general, the attention given to the notion of care within medical ethics has not been nearly as extensive as that given to issues corresponding with freedom, justice, or love. However, that notion could not be clearly outlined without the support of an account showing some activities linked to the human condition. The term care includes two meanings, one with an active character and the other passive. In the first, care refers to the attitude of attention, devotion, and effectiveness in the execution of a task. The passive meaning is related to the feeling of anxiety or preoccupation that overcomes a person burdened with worries. Both meanings intertwine, given that one cannot survive without the other. Until the Enlightenment, care had been understood above all in its positive social sense. Nevertheless, in the 19th century, the notion of care as subjective and solely linked to the individual developed. The care of others naturally derived from the care of oneself. The idea of care incorporated the experience of caring and being cared for. Being sick or in need leads someone who is ill to accept the health comfort from others. In this context, the health professions emphasize their expression of concern for those who are sick. However, The drive to develop an ethics of care came for the publication of Carol Gilligan's book In a Different Voice, Psychological Theory and Ethics, published in 1982. From this moment, an ethics of care was expanded in important ways. In general, professional competency has been essential for the ethos of Hippocratic medicine, the basis of Western medicine. Due to this, care had been associated with technical and competent care in a substantial part of the history of medicine. Furthermore, the scientific development of successful medicine from the second half of the 19th century through a large part of the 20th century has come to define medical care by measurable scientific data. This led to the idea of objective health. We can see the first radiology. Objective health and increased the distance between the illness and the patient, marginalizing to a large extent the care of a person and even bringing the act of caring into conflict with querying. Francis Peabody, a Harvard professor, believed that caring for the patient was something essential for medical practice, and doctors were required to do this in order to accomplish the end of medicine. His essay, The Care of the Patient, published in 1927, has been a landmark in the ethics of care of medicine in the 20th century. Peabody acknowledged that the enormous mass of scientific material to which a doctor must be exposed, the depersonalization of hospital practice, and the medical inclination that transforms organic illness into a mere consequence of clinical anatomy endangers the personal and human aspect of medical art. In order to remedy these urgent problems, he believes that doctors should promote attentive and respectful doctor-patient relationships. The impersonal treatment of an illness lengthens the curing process, reducing the effectiveness of the medical treatment. Care does, I quote, takes its proper place in the larger problem of the care of the patient, end quote, because medicine must be completely personal. The doctor should be attentive to the particular circumstances of each patient, I quote, not from the abstract point of view of the treatment of the disease, but from the concrete point of view of the care of the individual, end quote. Peabody thus emphasizes the necessity of care in the practice of good clinical medicine. This kind of care requires attentiveness to the patient's personality, sympathy for the patient's total situation, friendliness that elicits trust, and a consideration expressed in the little incidental things that you can do for his comfort. His maxim was, one of the essential qualities of the clinician is interest in humanity, for the secret of the care of the patient is in caring for the patient. Following Peabody, numerous doctors have written on the need for care in medical practice. In medical ethics, inclusion of virtues has had a particular repercussion on care for patients. As noted earlier, the notion of caring for entails acting in a benevolent as well as altruistic way. In medical context, care entails a basic moral orientation that helps mitigate technical medicine's dehumanizing effects. Objective and compassion complement the balance each other, says Edmund Pellegrino. For him, compassion is the habitual disposition to enter into the predicament of the sick person, to feel something of that predicament with him and as a result, to wish to help. Without this disposition, it could be impossible to cure in the complete sense of the word. For Pellegrino, caring for the patient implies, I quote, taking a personal interest in the patient's fate, or taking care in the way we carry out our professional duties, or taking care of the patient's needs and concerns. However, the notion of care is not sufficient to constitute the fundamentals of the theory of ethics. Objectivity, incorrect and competent attention should be combined with care as much as with compassion. The clinical evaluation of data obtained through the physical examination, biochemical analysis, or invasive technical procedures are the objective elements in the doctor-patient relationships. This evaluation aims to be completely objective, transcending emotions or feelings. To care involves respectfully addressing and bestowing benevolent treatment. Its opposite would be maltreatment or poor use, subjecting those around us to abuse or neglect. In this sense, to deal with someone or something would be identical to respecting and with caring for an object or person. In medicine, respect is a secular expression of the Hippocratic idea, the philia iatrike, a notion profoundly connected to the Christian command for charity to loving one's neighbor. It also refers to the attitude towards the civil dignity of man. Alan Donaghan shows that the philosophical nucleus of the morality of the Judeo-Christian tradition, one that derives from a monotheistic faith, can be condensed into this principle. It's not permissible to disrespect a human being, be it oneself or another. The subjective aspect of respect refers to an attitude of veneration, of deference, the capacity to grasp and process moral values. Only someone who is already respectful has the capacity to comprehend those notions. The same way that sensory deprivation atrophies the intelligence. Respect also implies an objective element that derives from when respect is given. There is a dignity that comes from being respected. In medicine, respect for life is united to an acceptance of vulnerability, of the fragility typical of persons, and the inevitability of sickness and death. Doctors do not have problems with the healthy and strong, but struggle with the ill and debilitated, with people who had lost their physical vigor and mental facilities. The blending of care and respect contributes to the medical care that does not discriminate or act paternalistically. Gonzalo Herranz has repeatedly presented a positive and fruitful idea for the progress of persons and society, consisting in understanding the value of the weak. To be weak in the Christian medical tradition entitles one to a qualified respect and protection. In some way, health confers the capacity to achieve the fullness of humanity and to suffer a chronic and incurable illness limits. A serious or incapacitating illness, if it is terminal, does not only consist in severe and critical molecular or cellular disorders. It consists mainly in the threatening of personal integrity that puts to test one's humanity. A physician should never forget this truth when he or she cares for the sick. The following example shows that the study and significance of care has already been usefully engaged through the recourse of narratives. Paul Ruskin was invited to present a lecture to a class of graduate nurses who were studying the psychosocial aspect of aging in 1997. He opened his lecture with the following case presentation. The patient is a white female who appears her age. She neither speaks nor comprehends the spoken word. Sometimes she babbles incoherently for hours. She is disoriented about person, place, and time. She does, however, seem to recognize her own name. I had worked with her for the past 6 months, but she still does not recognize me. She shows complete disregard for her physical appearance and makes no effort whatsoever to assist in her own care. She must be fed, bathed, and clothed by others. Because she is edentulous, her food must be pured, and because she is incontinent of both urine and stool, she must be changed and bathed often. Her shirt is generally soiled from almost incessant drooling. She does not walk. Her sleep pattern is erratic. Often she awakens in the middle of the night, and her screaming awakens others. Most of the time she is friendly and happy. However, several times a day she gets quite agitated with an apparent cause. Then she screams loudly until someone comes to comfort her. After this presentation, Ruskin asked the nurses how they would feel about taking care of a patient such as the one described. They used words such as frustrated, hopeless, depressed, and annoyed to describe how they would feel. Ruskin test ends by circulating among the participants a photo of the referred patient, a beautiful 6-month-old baby. After the audience protested that they felt themselves tricked by the professor, time was given to consider if their solemn and self-gratifying promise to not discriminate might yield to differences in weight, age, vital perspective, or feelings inspired by the physical appearances of the different patients, or if they need to overcome themselves these circumstantial details. Therefore, although there is a current peak in the promotion of a philosophy of care that privileges subjective aspects, it seems necessary for health professionals at least to search for a way of viewing the ill in a manner less controlled by feelings as prejudices. An elderly patient is as worthy of dignity and love as a child, and the ill that spends the last day of his or her existence incapacitated by dementia or pain merit the same care and attention as those beginning their lives with the helplessness of infancy. Medical ethics recommends that the professional should be guided by the search for the patient's greatest good. In 1939, Franz Alexander, one of the founders of psychosomatic medicine in the United States, argued that, I quote, "There is little doubt that the doctors often had a spectacular curative effect upon the sick, in certain respects even a more fundamental effect than many of our drugs. However, since ancient times, the therapeutic function of the physician-patient relationship had been emphasized as the success of the diagnosis and the treatment depend to a great extent on a good personal bond between the physician and the patient. On the contrary, if this link does not exist, effectiveness in patient care drops. It's often thought that scientific development was detrimental to the doctor-physician relationship. This author insists that doctors must consider the patient as a person and care for him by taking into account the set of factors that make up that individual. The current relationship between physicians and the patients, with the new attention to communication and the consideration of socio-environmental factors, reflect the influence of this movement. The affective phenomenon has its own perspective and is an important element in personality taken as a whole. Today, we often speak of confidence, hope, empathy, and compassion as key elements in the doctor-patient bond. The doctor who inspires such feelings or builds on them increases her healing capability. At the same time, the number of medical articles on the importance of communication between the doctor and patient has grown exponentially, and there is a movement to emphasize this strategy in the training of medical students. The ethical competence of a physician has been defined depending on the capacity of dialogue, the ability to deliberate, and the capacity to undertake a critical analysis. As a result, there has been an actualization of the importance of considering the person as a whole and the significance of the motions for health at illness. These publications remind us there is no difference between healing and curing in therapeutics, between a scientific technical competence and care. At the end of this presentation, we can point out that those who practice medicine must embody the double condition of carer of people and cultivator of science. This attitude allowed the art of medicine to be considered scientific medicine, given that the influence of the doctor-patient bond could no longer be considered a mere addendum to be treatment, an artistic or personal touch, but the main basic therapeutic factor. Care is related to respect when it contributes to the realization of the person we are caring for. It also involves the capacity to care in order to cure. To care respectfully undercuts the carer's servility and attends to the conviction of those receiving the care. To care, I'm ending the presentation, facilitates medical professionals' comprehension of their primary ethical duty. Respect for life, especially for the life of those who are most vulnerable. Thank you very much.